Now we're going to move on to a case study and hear some operational highlights from a real groundbreaking project in Australia for Sandfire Resources and the next steps in renewables for mines. So it's my pleasure to introduce Amram Roth Deblon. He's the head of global business initiatives for UV Renewable Energies. In his current role, he's responsible for global business initiatives, and the objective is to create value for UV's customers and to expand UV's business in key segments and markets globally.
Hello. Welcome all. So what I'm going to present you today is operational data from the Sandfire project. Some of you might have heard or read about it. It's a hybrid system that has been realized in 2016. And I show you how it's been doing and also how we see the future of renewable energy for mining in particular. Before I go into the details of that, I'll tell you where I come from and my company. UV Renewable Energy is a renewable energy specialist that has been developing and building projects, wind and solar, since more than 20 years. We've done 4,300 megawatts globally. It's also a German company, so you certainly hear an accent here also. This translates to an investment volume of around $10 billion. So a lot of money and a lot of time and effort, blood and sweat have gone into that. This is around 2,000 megawatt wind and a little bit more solar, 2,300 megawatts. The company is headquartered near Frankfurt. Has operations here in North America. Our colleagues from Boulder, Colorado are here. We've done a project, a small wind project in Canada. We're very strong in Asia, and I'm also glad to have a colleague here from the Africas, where we see a lot of demand in mining. We have around 1,000 people. That's the footprint, as I mentioned. And now let's get into the details of hybrids. So I'll first introduce a couple of terms that will familiarize yourself with mainly the off-grid industry or the off-grid power generation. So because you hear a lot about renewable contribution, penetration, fuel saving, it's all a bit mixed. And just so that we're all on the same page, how much solar or wind? You have three types of systems in general: low penetration, medium penetration, and high penetration. Yeah, what is a low penetration system? It's something that where solar or wind contribute around 7% of the fuel, and 7% of the overall energy correspondingly comes from renewables. But in terms of how much power on an instantaneous basis can be contributed during the day or windy period is around 15%. So it's important to maybe distinguish these two terms. So I've achieved something if we go out here and you remember we have two terms, penetration, number one, and contribution. So penetration is on power, contribution is how much on the overall energy consumption. So these are systems on low penetration that are relatively easy to implement. On medium penetration is anything between 8 to 20% of fuel displacement and up to 60% during the day, for example, of power. It's quite substantial. But that's not the end of the story. And UV has been an advocate since two decades for 100% renewables. So of course, that can be done even in a remote location. It's not easy and not always economical. That's why you won't see that very often. But it can be done. And that's what we call high penetration systems. So what are the differences? Low penetration systems is basically you plug into existing power system, heavy fuel oil generators or diesel generators, a small solar component where you hardly need any, you don't need a battery. Low penetration does not have a battery. Low penetration does also lack any meaningful integration technology, like a hybrid controller or so. And the gensets are strongly required, or the grid. Yeah? And it's not the lowest cost of electricity. More renewables will bring you lower cost of electricity, but it's a higher technology risk and more integration required. So medium penetration requires a hybrid controller. It can be with or without storage. That depends now what kind of control philosophy you follow. As it stands right now, in most locations, that's the optimized or the best levelized cost of electricity. The gensets are still required, but to a much lesser extent, so they run much less than the low penetration. And then what we heard from IM Gold, what he believes is the future. And by the way, yeah, our Sandfire system in Australia is such a medium penetration. And then you have high penetration, really going beyond 20% of fuel savings up to fully renewable solution with batteries, for example. And here it becomes technically more challenging, complex, and you can then have the grid or not, or generators or not, and probably as a backup. Okay, having said that, now I'm going to talk about the project that we did that was completed in June 2016. This is an actual aerial picture. It's not a 3D rendering. You see it's a copper and gold mine that has gone underground. Where did we start, and how long did it take to get the project off the ground? First contacts with Sandfire management in Australia took place in 2013. Where were we as an industry, mining and renewables? We had large experience in utility-scale solar, but with little penetration or little contribution on the overall power mix. We had a lot of off-grid systems that provided 100% electricity, but weren't deployed in an industrial or in mining environment. There were very few experienced players. There was no reference like that anywhere on the globe. Definitely not in mining, so it was a first. There were a lot of questions, and you might have similar questions here. How will the system affect power quality? An outage at the De Grasse mine of Sandfire costs per day $2 million. That's a no-no, yeah, absolute no-go. So it's very different to a rural electrification project. How much solar will we actually be able to use? Because there are diesel generators, and some solar generation might not be usable because power demand might be low. A mine site, is there a lot of dust? How often do we have to clean the modules? This is in the Australian outback. Will it operate in these harsh environments, temperatures almost up to 50 degrees centigrade? With fly-in, fly-out operations, we can't just truck in things very quickly. And then, of course, the life of mine. We were starting development when the mine had a confirmed mine life of 7 years. When the project went operation was 5.5 years. So all economics are based on a 5.5 year mine life. I think this is a major challenge and also achievement of that project. And what is the best commercial structure? Yeah. Okay, so this is an overview of the mine. Sandfire Resource is a premier high-grade copper producer in Asia-Pacific, 900 kilometers north of Perth, running fully on diesel, 23 megawatts, a fleet of generators, an average load of 13.5 megawatts, around 100 gigawatt hours per year consumption. That's a solar system as it is right now, 10.6 megawatt, single axis tracked, so it follows the sun, the size of 40 football pitches, or soccer pitches, as you would say here in North America. It has a 6 megawatt battery. Yeah, we require that for spinning reserve. It's a lithium ion battery. Again, the gensets I've already said, and UV is a developer in EPC. We are not the tech company that sells or develops technology. However, when we encounter solutions in the market, things that are not available, we come up with our own solution. And the SCADA means the monitoring of all generation assets, the diesel power station, solar, battery, and the whole integration wasn't available. And we came up with what we call now the UV hybrid SCADA, which enables the owner and the operator of the plant to see in real life in 1 second interval what the system is doing. Quite instrumental. And now I would show you a video. It goes just 3 minutes, so you see the project.
A new 10.6 megawatt solar facility plus 6 megawatt battery integrated with an existing diesel power station at the De Grasse copper gold mine in Western Australia is a first for the mining industry and a first in the rapidly growing renewable energy sector. The project represents the future of the mining industry with more sustainable and lower cost power. Located 900 kilometres northeast of Perth in Western Australia, DeGrussa is one of the Asia-Pacific region's premier high-grade copper mines. An outstanding greenfields discovery in 2009, the rapid development of this high-grade deposit in just over 3 years transformed Sandfire into a leading mid-tier mining company, propelling it to the forefront of copper production in Western Australia. In October 2013, Sandfire Resources was approached by Dewey, a leading international renewable energy construction company, to procure electricity from a 10.6 megawatt solar photovoltaic PV facility, which it proposed to install at the DeGrussa mine. After signing a power purchase agreement and securing $20.9 million from the Australia Renewable Energy Agency, ARENA, the project ownership was transferred to French independent power producer Neoen in July 2015 at financial close of the project. Neoen are the project financier responsible for providing equity and securing $15 million funding from the Clean Energy Finance Corporation, CEFC. The solar PV system is expected to produce around 21,000 megawatt hours of electricity per annum and reduce diesel consumption at DeGrussa by approximately 5 million litres per year, with a forecast reduction in carbon dioxide emissions by an estimated 12,000 tonnes. During a typical 24-hour period, the mine's energy demand is relatively consistently at around 12 megawatts. During the evening, the mine is completely powered by diesel. As the sun rises, more power is produced from the solar panels and the diesel generators are progressively turned off. A control system works to balance the diesel, solar and battery generation to ensure sufficient reserve capacity is always available in the event of clouds blocking the sun. When a cloud event occurs, a portion of the energy demand is taken by the reserve diesel capacity already online, with the battery able to meet the balance of demand until new diesel generators can be started and brought online. Once the cloud passes, the power station reverts back to solar power and turns off the diesel generators, which are no longer needed for the time being. As the afternoon approaches and the amount of sunlight reduces, the diesel generators provide a greater proportion of the mine's power needs. During the evening, while the solar power facility itself does not produce any electricity, the battery has the ability to continue providing auxiliary services such as frequency control, power factor correction, as well as a spinning reserve, thereby increasing the overall reliability of the diesel power station.
So that was all theory, right? That video was done before the or during the construction. Did it all pan out as we predicted? We're glad it actually did. We have around 60% of daylight power consumption being provided by solar. We have around 2 gigawatt hours of generation per month currently. This equates to 450,000 liters of diesel saved every month. That's a typical day. This day is, I took this graph from the 19th of November. This is just a bit more than a week ago. You see, this is a very beautiful sunny day in the Australian outback, fantastic solar resource over there. But of course, there are also some clouds, and I'll show that a bit later, just to show you how the overall power generation looks like. The gray here on this pie chart is the diesel generation. The blue is what comes from solar, and the little purple speck is it's a contribution from the battery. So it's not much. And the battery here is not a battery that provides really energy storage, but it's a power battery. It provides spinning reserve. It helps balancing out the overall power system. And that's just, you know, to see a couple of days and not only one. Now I go a bit deeper, and bear with me, yeah, the non-technical folks, just to, before we go into the technical, maybe to hear what do the stakeholders have to say. And I'm very glad this is a recent, especially from recent statements. The man in charge of the overall power system, Peter Gordon from Sandfire Resources, he's an electrical superintendent. He's a man to that we have to make happy, yeah, in order to be successful. And I'm very glad that he states that the system now than since more than a year in operation, is as good or better in reliability than the power system before. I think that's a bold statement, and he's a guy that has to basically report that to the mine manager and to the CEO of Sandfire, who also stated quite a lot of interest and benefits to his company by the Sandfire project. And of course, Arena, who put almost 21 million Australian dollar into the project, are happy that we built on time and within budget. Okay, now this is a real life picture from, again, 19th of November. The black line here, let me see, if is that a point? No, it's not. I would have loved to have a pointer. Okay, then you just, I hope you follow me. The black jiggery line is actual power demand at the site. The orange one is the solar irradiation. That's basically the available solar energy. On the left side, you see 16 megawatt is a top line, around 13.5 to 15 megawatt of power consumption, pretty stable. Some vent fans, bore mills, turning on or off at some point in time, so you know, air conditioning loads changing. And now this is where it gets interesting. The brown curve is diesel. As the sun rises, diesel generation goes down because solar power generation goes up, and you see that correspondingly. And this is a perfectly sunny day. There is no cloud. Yeah? Of course, that's not always the case. But what you also see, there's some, you know, initially there's a step change. What is that? You see that the solar is then, you know, up and down and up and down. That's not because the sun is going up and down. That is because we lose solar energy. Because the power system, we have a genset still on in partial load where solar energy cannot be fed into the grid, right? And at some point, the power system or the energy demand hits a certain threshold, and that additional power can be put on, can be fed on. So that's something something important to keep in mind. The battery here, that's a purple line, doesn't do much. It's not required at this point in time because it only balances. Yeah, there's a little bit of supply, but that's not, and that's how we've designed the system. Now, this is a day where we have clouds. Yeah, so you see, there's quite significant loss, and this is probably 60% of power output within a 5-minute period. That's something that the energy management system or the hybrid controller has to deal with. And that's what everyone is concerned about, yeah, because solar is an intermittent resource. But when you look at the black line on top, do you see any corresponding dip? No. So the system works, and I show you how. Solar, of course, output follows the irradiation. And then you see this is a battery. The battery is a super fast response. It provides instantaneous current and power to balance the drop in output from solar and ramp it down in a controlled way. And then here, it's too much clutter with all the other graphs. It's still the same day. You see what the diesel is doing. Pretty stable. Then the battery provides energy, and the diesel within its existing spinning reserve provide the balance. And then when solar is coming back, the battery gets charged. That's when the peak goes the other way, way down. Most important takeaway of this graph is the overall power output is completely stable. Yeah, no matter what demand is. If you put on a vent fan, a bore mill, any of the machinery, it's being supplied reliably. This is now the showcase. What I'm going to tell you next is a bit about how does the market evolve from our point of view. We see that most mining companies now, either new developments or operational mines, are looking at renewables and are looking at solar or wind. But they don't look immediately at what we did at Sandfire, right? They look at this and they say, okay, let's dip our toes first and do a low penetration system. Understandably, it's a totally new technology at their site. They want to see it perform at the site. So even for something with 20 megawatt load, where you could do easily 10 or more megawatt solar, as I've shown you, most companies look right now at 2 to maybe 8 megawatt. Some are more bold or are bolder and look at medium to high penetration. But at the moment, I think that the trend is more low penetration. Again, the lowest cost of electricity would not come from the low penetration system. The more solar right now you deploy, or the more wind, normally it will provide you the lowest cost of electricity, even at shorter power purchase agreement tenors, I would say up, sub 10 years. And of course, there are several projects globally under development, of course, from our side and from many others. I mean, we've heard construction for the Essakane project in Burkina Faso. We are very happy to see something like that going forward, because it will educate and help the whole industry move to greater uptake on the renewable side. What is happening on the technology front? One thing that we see as an enabler for sites that have existing power stations, existing diesel or heavy fuel oil, is that we look at low load capability. Yeah? Because that would, as I showed you earlier, there was some solar that we lost, right? And that is because the gensets are not programmed in a way that they can tolerate low load. Of course, fuel efficiency goes down, but I think low load capability is definitely an enabler. Relocatable solutions, like what my previous German colleague presented, is a very important part of the puzzle. Yeah, we see a lot of PPAs that are maybe 5 years, and or even shorter. So something that can be packed up and redeployed. Our system at Sandfire is redeployable apart from the mounting structure. Everything else is containerized. The mounting structure, you have to unscrew, leave the piles in the ground, or pull them out, right? This is a tracking solution. Cloud forecasting, yeah, so that you can even probably reduce battery capacity for your solar ramp rate. And of course, and I spared that for the last, everyone's talking about batteries, we also, and that's a big enabler. Just to give you scale of magnitude, battery prices between 2010 and 2016 have fallen so that they're today only 25% of what they were. Yeah, cascaded, it looks like this. So $1,000 bought you a kilowatt hour in 2016. 2017 now, you will probably pay around $250. You can find this data from Bloomberg New Energy Finance. It's available in the web. And this market will grow really exponentially. We are talking today about a market for stationary power storage or energy storage of, 20, 30 gigawatt hours. This market will double six times. Double six times, that's the forecast, until 2030. And that's, of course, on the back of the cost reductions. So I've been in that industry for more than 20 years, in the renewable energy industry, and that looks very much what I've seen since probably between 2004, 2005, and now on the solar and wind side. So I'm pretty bullish about this. What are the challenges? There are some challenges. You would ask me, wow, looks all so rosy. Why there are not hundreds of projects? Yeah, it's not as easy as it sounds to shift from a unified, tried and tested thermal power supply from one source to a mix of, you know, erratic sun and wind, providing power to my mine. Yeah, so it's also a change in processes and understanding the resource, understanding the technology. The PPA duration, power purchase agreement duration, and mine life is a challenge, and that's why I said relocatable solutions are I think big will be a big enabler. And mining requirements are very different, even from the strictest power industry requirements. Yeah? To design a system and to run through all the health and safety requirements and scenario analysis on a mine site is very different. So we have spent a lot of time and effort to weed out even the smallest nitty-gritty possibility of a battery catching fire, power failure, yeah, anything. So that's something that is a challenge, can be addressed. Control system integration in SCADA, as I said, when we go into medium and high penetration solar, this is very important, and it's not fully, I would say, plug and play yet. Yeah, there's still, there's a few companies that have products, but it's still early times. Yeah, Then on the grid connected side, firming power. So you maybe, if you have a grid connected mine with large, maybe 100 megawatt load, you could easily put 150 megawatt solar power facility up there, but then you need to find someone that contracts with you to supply the balance, right? So that's a challenge. It's possible, but it is a commercial challenge. Grid connection and power export is a challenge. A lot of the mines, it would make total commercial sense in South Africa, for example, for many resource companies to have on-site grid-connected power supply, but they simply don't get like a generation license, so or not even allowed to export any of the excess. Energy wheeling, so for example, you have a mine site connected to the grid, but there's this fantastic wind resource 100 kilometer up there where you could have a wheeling arrangement, energy wheeling contract. That's, I think, one of the challenges. Legislation need to enable that. CO2 and energy policy, I think that's a very moving target, and I think we've heard a lot of details about that. That remains a challenge. And now I'm going to talk a little bit about what we had on the TED talk yesterday, the mine of the future, and I've taken the Sandfire mine as an example. So again, here's the system as of today, 10.6 megawatt, that's a physical footprint. We could do, with a longer tenor, already much more there in a commercial sense, and I'm going to show you how. We could cover 100% of the daytime electricity usage with solar. We would have to double the system a little bit more in size, and the footprint would be, as you see here, a little bit more than double, 27 megawatt solar. This is much more than what the daily load is. Remember, the daily load is around 13.5 to 14 megawatts, so you need a sizable energy storage. That's a 20 megawatt hour battery. This is 10 times the size as it is right now. Natural question that comes from you, okay, sounds technically all cool, but I'm not a techie, I have to run a stock listed company. What's the payback? First of all, the payback is based on how much diesel you save, 11.5 million liters as compared to 5 million as we save today. This would save 31,000 tons per year as compared to 12,000 as it is right now. And this system, as it stands today, would pay back in 5 to 6 years. Not so long, but not an economic case with a mine life of 5.5 years, right? Okay, now I go bold. So we've heard about the first fully electric underground mine yesterday. Very exciting. Yeah, it's the last one. We could do that at Sandfire, and then you see this is a massive solar array. Yeah, we still talk about the same day and night, 13.5 megawatts, but all mobile equipment now, underground, also electric, you could cover with 120 megawatt solar, and that's a massive battery. That's like more than 100 times the size as it is right now. Wow, that sounds like unfinanceable, but the payback isn't that bad. It would save 45 million liters of diesel, a lot of CO2, and the payback as it is right now, 9 to 13 years. No option for Sandfire, but it's not totally off the chart. Now I look, how would that be in 5 years or 2030? And that's based on Bloomberg New Energy Finance or other reliable forecasts on solar power and battery power reductions. And this are, just to put that number into perspective, my calculation is based on $42 per liter fuel, and between 3.5% to 7% annual cost reduction. It's not very ambitious. Not very ambitious, yeah? So the payback for the first system, day and nighttime, was around 4 years, less than 4 years, in 2023. In 2030, it would be below 3 years. So a no-brainer for a mine with 5 years. Now this is the very ambitious one, yeah, the 120 megawatts. You could pay back within 6 years in 2023, within 6 years. And in 2030, you could pay back this massive system, like 120 megawatt solar systems for, you know, this is not a huge mine, this is like a 13 megawatt mine that is underground and produces copper within around 4.5 years. And with that, I think I want to finish. Now the question that you might have is, should I wait? No, because until 2030, no, because your PPA gets shorter every year, and the PPA cost reduction is for a year shorter is around 25% per year, depending on the duration, versus your technology cost reduction, which is between 3.5% and maybe below 10%. So no, you shouldn't wait. If you have a project today that needs power, look into renewables, and I hope we can, we can help you with that.